it's really, it really saddens my heart for the reason that most people don't understand this, why we come into the kingdom of God. A lot of people think, you know, the North American standard basically is give your life to Jesus so that when you die, you can go to heaven. You know, that's the message that's been proclaimed for a long time, and it's true, and there's nothing wrong with it, but there's so much more to it than that. God wants us to be active participants with Him in doing His work upon the earth, first and foremost. To know that we can, when we give our lives to Jesus, we can then become partakers in the plan of God to redeem the earth. That already He's done everything that's necessary. Now what God is calling us to do is to do what He's called us to do, which is proclaim light in darkness. And it's sad that most people don't understand that. They're waiting to die and go to heaven instead of becoming active participants in what He's doing upon the earth. I was fortunate enough to, when I gave my life to Jesus, that it was at an Amway convention, and where, you know, you'd least expect to get connected with Jesus. But the guy told me, he says, you know, the guy preaching, he says, you know, don't think that your life's going to get easier now because you've given your life to Jesus. He says, it's going to get harder. He was strong enough to tell the truth about it. He wasn't preaching for a job. He was preaching because he was a businessman who loved Jesus and wanted to connect as many people to Jesus as he could. So I was told right away, like, I heard it. I don't know if anybody else in the church heard it, but I heard him say it. And so I heard those words, and we left, and I was excited. I was transformed. I was an atheist, you know, former alcoholic, and I didn't believe in God. And all of a sudden, I just had this passion to serve God. I felt the presence of God. God, the grace of God filled the room, and my life changed forever. And it was the beginning point of where this all began. But right immediately, as soon as we gave our lives to the Lord, Shelley had been saved about 3 months before me, and then I gave my life, and Jesus rescued me, and then we went home, and then all hell broke loose. It was crazy. We had people criticizing us, condemning us, and it was first couple of days. It was kind of disheartening. Like, what's going on here? And actually, one church, they preached about us for three Sundays in a row that we got involved in a cult. And there was people that were going there that actually left that church because of what they were saying about us. They told us the whole story. And so I was mad at first, but then I got excited and I figured, this is real. Because they don't really know what we did. But yet all this criticism and all this stuff broke out, and I got excited. I said, this is the real deal. I remembered the words of that pastor or that businessman that said, it's not going to get easier, it's going to get harder. You have now entered the war zone. You have now entered the war zone. It wasn't for me. Like, I didn't understand what he was talking about, but after 21 years, I've been getting to figure it out. That there's a war going on. And he wants his people activated to go out into the world and shed light where there's darkness. Brilliant light. And it has been so exciting. There's been times, like Charlie says, there's times where you don't feel like this is going very well. But through revelation, as Kim talked last night, when you get revelation, that never leaves you. That never leaves you. It's always the revelation of God is always there. It never leaves you. It's not a theoretical thing that, oh, I'm going to try. A lot of people say, well, I'm going to give my life to Jesus. I'm going to give it a try. Don't bother. It's never going to work for you. If you're just going to give it a try, it's not going to work. It's like, this is it. This is the only thing there is. And come hell or high water, you know, I am not, all hell comes at me, if high water comes at me, I'm not backing down, I'm sticking with Jesus. Because he's the reality. He's the exact representation of who God is. Amen? Amen. And there's Nathan. He's pumped all the time. I love Nathan. I love all you guys. You guys are amazing. But just to understand that there's a battle out there. We are in a war zone. And this is the most amazing thing that you can be involved in upon the earth. Because I never suffer from boredom, ever. If you're boredom, you're just not doing this thing right yet. Right? If you have boredom, you're just not doing this right yet. Because there's no boredom in the kingdom of God. There's never a moment. There's times I say, Lord, could I just have a little bit of boredom maybe today? You know? But then again, who wants that? Who wants any of this stuff? But there, right from the beginning, I knew that there was something going on, that there was a battle. And in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10 to 13, it says, finally, be strengthened by the Lord and by his vast strength. I'm reading out of the Holman Christian Standard Bible. Verse 11 says, put on the full armor of God so that you can stand against the tactics of the devil. For our battle is not against flesh and blood, but against rulers, against authorities, against the powers of this darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavens. This is why you must take up the full armor of God, so that you may be able to resist in the evil day. And having prepared everything, take your stand. And it goes on to say, stand. Take on the full armor of God. Why would they be talking? Why would Paul be? going on. There's a war going on, and it's 24 hours a day. And if you're not aware of it, it'll kill you. It'll take you down. If you're coming into the kingdom just so that your life can become rosy and cushy and all that stuff, it'll take you down. But being aware of the war that we're in, I know that I'm going to get attacked spiritually, because this part, the enemy doesn't lay down on the ground and cry. And because we did something, he comes back, he counteracts. Like the battle, had Kim and Lynn not had the armor of God on, when they went to Guatemala and they seen those creatures,
Ace.
And then again in brackets, favored privilege was granted and graciously entrusted to proclaim to the Gentiles the unending, boundless, fathomless, incalculable, and exhaustless riches of Christ. Wealth which no human being could have searched out, also to enlighten all men and make plain to them what is the plan regarding the Gentiles and providing. God I want. You know, when I was a teenager, I tried committing suicide 5 times in my life. And here's the strange part about it. I was the life of every party that I went to. That's the deception. The mask that was on me, that was the deception. Everybody said, oh, you had such a good time. You had so much fun. And every night I'd go home and I wonder, how can I kill myself without hurting somebody? How can I do it without hurting my mom and dad? And how can I just evaporate and get off this earth and just get out of this? And yet everybody that I was surrounded by thought I was the life of the party. Well, that kind of life you don't want to have nothing to do with. It's horrible. It's a horrible place to be in. But never spoke in front of anybody in my life. I went to this little Baptist church, and all I did was cry the whole time. I got up behind the pulpit, and I cried. And I couldn't get a word out of my mouth. And I was so humiliated. What in the world? And all these, they're older people, they're gracious and everything. Wonderful. They were crying too. So we feel sorry for that guy. No, actually, they knew where I came from. They knew what kind of background I had. And so, anyway, this guy walked up to me and walking on the aisle.
town, so what do you think they're going to do to me? They're going to take me to the sewer and drown me, right? And he says, no, you're going to do it. I said, no, no way. And so this is weeks are going on. We're fighting back and forth. I said, I'm not doing it. And so the Lord, and I didn't tell anybody, not a soul, not even Shelley. I said, okay, I will do it as if they phone me, and that's the only way I'm going to do it. And I knew they'd never call me. They're never going to come and call me and say, come and speak to the church, the whole church, the entire church. And so they one Sunday morning at 7 o'clock in the morning, out of nowhere, the phone rings, and here it's the chairman of the board. He says, Terry, I just want to tell you, today is your day. I'm half asleep, and I'm not good in the morning more normally. And I say, what do you mean it's my day? Today's the day you speak, you bring your testimony to the entire church in Norquay, the Covenant Church. I said, no. Today? I said, I'm not ready. I've got nothing. And 20 minutes just about killed me with 20 people from the youth group. 200 people is going to be 10 times worse. It's going to kill me for sure. I said, no, I'm not going to do it. He said, Terry, you know you have to speak to these people today. You know it. I know it. I said, how do you know it? He says, I know it. So I go, okay. So I go, I wake up, I have a shower, I start trying to write notes. I couldn't. I said, this is going to be terrible. My last experience in front of a church, I cried the whole time. I never spoke one word. This time it's going to be worse. These people know me. And so I went, and I went, I couldn't write any notes, I couldn't think of anything, and I spoke that day for 45 minutes nonstop, and I declared the goodness of God. And it was unbelievable, and then I felt the call to preach at that moment, and the importance of declaring how awesome God is. I didn't understand about the principalities and the powers and the rulers and all that stuff, but every time we do, and every time we lift up the name of God, His presence comes and overpowers those principalities and those rulers of darkness that we don't need to fight because He takes them out for us. Amen? And so, it's about declaring who He is. His greatness, His awesomeness, His amazing abilities and his power, you know. Kim, he's so humble and he was here one time and I forget how you put it, but he said if God could use a donkey, he said one. Yeah, I think it was a donkey like me. If he can speak through a donkey like me, he can use it. And here's this guy that's changing Guatemala, but when he speaks about God, He's just lifting the mighty name of God up, and God is tearing down. When God's power, you see, it's kind of like this. It's when there's an explosion. You know, if you have the powder or the dynamite in one area and it blows out like that, is this concussion goes out. When God comes in, it just forces the enemy right out. It's just, it's gone.
The very same thing. You want to talk about the devil being your friend. You know, some people say, oh, he's my friend. Yeah, right. He's your friend. The day my sister died, at 7 o'clock in the morning on a Friday. I think it was a Friday. And at about, I was going to, my brother, two brothers and I, Ken here, the bus driver. Ken, that's my brother Ken. He says, you guys are amazing. The Esten College guys, he says, amazing kid, amazing people. But in her, because she was the first one in our family that became born again. When she was 8 years old, she was born again. There was nobody in our family saved until she gave her life to Jesus. She started praying for us, and then our family started coming into the kingdom because of an 8-year-old girl. I stand up here today. And as a teenager, as a young girl, she left the church, and you know, maybe not past teenager, later on, she left the church and kind of lost her connection with God. And the connection was being made again, and the enemy tried to snuff that out and destroy her. But Isabella lives today because of who he is. Because that's what he came to set the captive free. He came to heal the sick, cast out demons, and raise the dead. And he's called us as a people to do that. In Jesus' name. Amen. And if you want to talk about, did I have the faith, did I have mighty faith that day? I had no faith. It felt like zero faith. It felt like less than mustard seed faith.